If you're a parent of young children, the chances are that you've met these monsters. If you haven't, then let me introduce you. They are wild things. Their creator is Maurice Sendak, author and illustrator of children's books. His books are as intriguing or amusing or disturbing to adults as they are fascinating for children. Some critics find obscure Freudian implications in his works. Some parents think Sendak's world is too scary for kids. And a few librarians are simply embarrassed. Sendak is a 44-year-old bachelor who draws on the fantasies of his own childhood. We went to visit the creator of the wild things in his lair, deep in the forests of Connecticut. Sendak is recognized in the publishing world as the most important author and illustrator of children's books alive. He works at them with a dedication rarely shown in a field overpopulated by the cute and the easy and the saccharine. He whistles while he works, often with the stereo playing Mozart and the television blasting with afternoon soap operas. His best-known titles are Where the Wild Things Are, Hector Protector, Higgledy Piggledy Pop, or There Must Be More to Life, In the Night Kitchen. His books have been translated into 12 languages. They have sold well over 1 million copies. Sendak has won all the prizes in his field: the Caldecott Award, the Pulitzer of Children's Books, the Hans Christian Andersen Prize, the Nobel of Children's Books.
One of the critics, a friendly critic, said that you're the most powerful man in the United States, shaping the fantasies of millions of children. Is that true?
I'd like to believe it. It's a little scary, if true. But I suppose people like myself who are doing books for children are really in a position to influence a lot of attitudes in children. Certainly, and what's most important, what I'd be most concerned with, is that we're shaping taste, too.
The best known of Sendak's books is this one, Where the Wild Things Are. And if you don't know about the wild things, then we'd better pause right here. I'm going to read you and show you the whole book, but don't be frightened, it only takes about 3 minutes. Don't be frightened by the wild things either. For monsters, they're very friendly creatures. It begins.
The night Max wore his wolf suit and made mischief of one kind and another, his mother called him Wild Thing. And Max said, I'll eat you up. So he was sent to bed without eating anything. That very night, in Max's room, a forest grew. And grew, and grew until his ceiling hung with vines, and the walls became the world all around. And an ocean tumbled by with a private boat for Max, and he sailed off through night and day, and in and out of weeks, and almost over a year, to where the wild things are. And when he came to the place where the wild things are, they roared their terrible roars and gnashed their terrible teeth and rolled their terrible eyes and showed their terrible claws till Max said, be still, and tamed them with the magic trick of staring into all their yellow eyes without blinking once. And they were frightened and called him the most wild thing of all and made him king of all wild things. And now, cried Max, let the wild rumpus start. Now stop, Max said, and sent the wild things off to bed without their supper. And Max, the king of all wild things, was lonely and wanted to be where someone loved him best of all. Then all round, from far away across the world, he smelled good things to eat. So he gave up being king of where the wild things are. But the wild things cried, oh, please don't go. We'll eat you up. We love you so. And Max said, no. The wild things roared their terrible roars and gnashed their terrible teeth and rolled their terrible eyes and showed their terrible claws But Max stepped into his private boat and waved goodbye. And sailed back over a year and in and out of weeks and through a day and into the night of his very own room, where he found his supper waiting for him. And it was still hot.
Just how do children respond to a book like Where the Wild Things Are? Well, all kinds of adults have all kinds of adult theories about how they respond. So we decided to go to five professionals, professional children, to find out what they think of the wild things. Kim.
I like
the
book.
Mm-hmm. What do you like about it?
Because there are monsters in it.
Yeah. Do you like monsters?
I do, but I don't destroy them every week.
Uh-huh. Tell me, Zachary.
Well, I don't like monsters because I don't watch scary movies, but books are okay.
Do you like scary stories? Do you like to be scared a little bit?
A little, but not much.
When you look at this book and see some of these monsters, these wild things, do you think about it afterwards and are you frightened of them?
No.
In the book, the man says that Max was the most wild thing of all, that he was even more wild than the monsters.
It's not true.
It's not true?
No.
You don't think that a little boy could be even wilder than a wild thing?
A little, but not that much.
Uh-huh. I know a number of children who read The Wild Things, and it's just the opposite of fear or fright, the monsters, mm-hmm. and the wild things. They find them very funny, very amusing.
Yeah. That's been my experience, too, that they're very comical and klutzy and goofy and clumsy, and they can handle them very easily.
By staring into their yellow eyes.
Into their yellow eyes without blinking once. In the case of Night Kitchen, it was not so much a question of it being frightened, it was a question of Mickey being nude. It was a business of frontal nudity, this child falling out of his pajamas through the night. Some people, some few librarians in this country, were mortally offended. And one even went so far as to suggest that do as she did, which was take a bottle of white temper and paint a little diaper on him, so that when she read the book to the children, not that the kids would not be offended, that she wouldn't be offended, or he.
All the little boys in your book, Mickey in the Night Kitchen, shouting, screaming, quiet down there. Max in The Wild Things telling his mother that he's going to eat her up. Pierre saying, I don't care, and nothing much else. They're all pretty pugnacious little kids, what we used to call brats.
Mm-hmm.
Why brats?
Why brats? Well, it's not what I would call a brat. I would call a brat some whining, irritating child who was sitting frustrated in the corner chewing his nails and making irritating noises. Whereas a kid who really explodes, I mean, that may be another kind of irritation, but he's letting you know exactly. I mean, when the kid says, I don't care, it might enrage you and you want to just clonk him on the head, but at least he's stating a fact. I much prefer that. A child who will let it out and express his feelings. And this is what they're doing, really. I mean, hopefully, it's all they're doing. I mean, Max is just getting mad, and Mickey's annoyed, and Pierre is irrational.
You don't sentimentalize childhood particularly.
No, I remember nothing sentimental about it. I mean, I happen to remember a good deal of my own childhood. And only grown-ups on Christmas TV specials sentimentalize about childhood. We're learning, we're suffering, and children suffer as intensely and as keenly as adults do. And let nobody tell you different. And it's just a hard time to live. I sure the hell don't want to be telling them lies or sweet nothings, but I want to be telling them not hard truths about life, but I want to tell them what's true about the particular subject I'm writing about for them, that's all. So that one really has to watch oneself more, perhaps, than any other creative profession.
When you sit down to write and illustrate a children's book, are you consciously sitting there and trying to get certain things into it for children?
No. I mean, God forbid. I mean, that's almost the worst way of doing it, if one set out to do it that way. Now, I'm doing a book for myself. then it happens somehow or other to be a book for children. I mean, I'd like it, sometime I would have liked it, I'd like it to be a grown-up book. I mean, grown-up things happen to me, like you and your friends and my friends. But when grown-up things happen to me, they're not interpreted creatively in those terms. They turn into pigs and dogs and that kind of thing. I mean, there are certain rules and regulations that do come into writing books for children. Max is not going to stay on the Wild Things Island. He's going to come home to Mama, to Papa, and to eat his dinner. And Pierre's going to come out of the line. We're not there to frighten kids or to, you know, tell them terrible stories. We're there to scare them a little bit, give them a good time, but basically to give them something that they can put all together again at the end, and it's all right.